who died 10 years ago today, with the first of two programmes profiling his life and work. I Don't Sing Like Nobody.
Ten years ago, Elvis Presley died. His death was sudden, but in a matter of hours, there were thousands of mourners outside his Memphis home. It was the most extraordinary demonstration of public grief since the death of Valentino.
I think it really hit me after I came back to Los Angeles. And I remember sitting in a theater. I'd gone to a movie by myself, and I'd seen all these people. I forgot the name of the movie, in fact, because my attention wasn't even on it. But I remember looking around and going, how is this world going to survive without Elvis Presley? Because he was such a big part of life.
Where will I go?
He took up a large part of my life. We were like brothers at times. I was a doctor at times. At times he tried to play the doctor. I was a father role. I may be a counselor. I may be whatever. And we just spent a lot of time together. And of course, I miss him a lot.
I admired him so very much because he was so damn different from anybody I'd ever met. I still remember how he held his hand and his little finger when he would sing, you know, that little finger would stick out. He's just so very different, and I admire people who are great showmen, and because I never had that, you know. I could never jump around and play. I'd miss it. I'd screw up somewhere, but he could do that.
He grew up around black children, so there were times when he was loose-limbed and very casual in his demeanor and very hip. He had a stance like no one else had. He had a walk like no one else had.
It is
snarl in his lip like no one else had. He had a laugh like no one else had. He had the most riveting presence of any human being I've ever encountered. He was truly a one of a kind.
Elvis came from the South, from the cotton land of the Mississippi Delta. Even now, the South is different from the North. 50 years ago, it was almost another country.
Why don't I be wrong with you?
On his father's side, Elvis's inheritance was mainly Scottish. His mother's blood was more exotic. his Smith grandparents, he was of Cherokee Indian descent, and his grandmother was also partly Jewish. When they married, Vernon was 17 and worked on a dairy farm. Gladys was 21, a seamstress at the Tupelo garment factory. They lived with family until she fell pregnant, when Vernon borrowed $180 from his employer and built a two-room shack on some land owned by his father.
Some place where you can be queen for a day.
The little house, restored by enthusiastic caretakers, now seems like a bijou residence, complete with wallpaper. It was in far less comfortable circumstances that Gladys went into labor in January 1935. She gave birth to twins, the first stillborn.
My mother came when Elvis was born to bring a diaper layette to diaper Elvis because the presses were in dire circumstances. And Dr. William Robert Hunt, who delivered him, was our Sunday school teacher and delivered all of us. And he announced on prayer meeting on Wednesday night that the Presleys had had twins, and would the good ladies of the church come out and give them some assistance. It was raining that day, and Vernon told me that Brother Holly said, "Vernon, you go on home and we'll take care of the burial." He had a terrible cough from having to work outside in the weather. So
many days. Vernon's dairy work fell away, and he had to take odd jobs. They were very poor. And when Elvis was three, his father was desperate enough to swindle his old boss out of a few dollars. He was caught.
I can't change my clothes. I wonder how long.
The law bore down hard, and he was sent to Parchman Farm Prison for 3 years.
So many days we need, they would be cold. They would have us out in the rain and cold.
Their house was taken from them, and the little boy and his mother again forced to live with relatives. When he was six, Elvis began a grade school, and his friend Becky Martin started the same day.
Our school would go to the auditorium, and we had chapel each morning before school, and at different times Elvis would perform, and he would sing Old Shep and God Bless My Daddy and A Leaf on the Tree, and he was real good at singing all the songs, and we would cry. I would, and lots of people in the auditorium did. She was shy, like, but she was sociable with the neighbors that lived close to her. She wouldn't let him go any place unless she went along with him. She walked him to school. She would walk him across the highway every morning to school, and then she would come back in the afternoon to pick him up. But she would let him come to our grocery store and get ice cream.
The Presleys attended the First Assembly Church of God, which had a young pastor.
They were quite regular in church. Elvis was, in fact, even sometimes when the parents did not feel like coming, Elvis would come on himself anyway. But they were pretty regular in coming. And during revivals, if they didn't come every night, Elvis would come himself.
I never saw a Presley that couldn't sing. And they would sing, and it was a music of the oppressed. And it was the music of the fact that there's going to be a better place. And they would sing, "Some Glad Morning I'll Fly Away." And, you know, we were all just ready to load the bus.
I've always played a guitar and sang during service. And I still do. I felt like he drew some inspiration from my playing and singing, and he wanted to do that. So he got him a guitar, and then he bought him a book to show him where to place his fingers to make the chords.
The guitar, bought at the hardware store, was something of a compromise. Elvis had really wanted a bicycle, but his parents couldn't afford one. Even the guitar was a stretch.
Now, I didn't teach Elvis, but I did help him after he had learned how to arrange his fingers and to play, and he was already playing and had begun to sing with him, with his own playing. Well, I went to his house and showed him how to make what we call runs, or to make the guitar talk. Now, that's what I helped him with.
He always sang when they called on him. There were no problem there. And like they would clap and he would sing again. So that's how well they liked it. This particular photograph with Magdalene, she played the piano and organ and sang some. So could have been musically the reason that they was together, but I didn't think about him as being the little rough boy. He was just a nice-mannered child. Didn't go for all the rough playing. But I wasn't with him all the time, so maybe, you know, he did different when he was with other people.
The Presleys were never on the uptown side of Tupelo's tracks. Another move took them near to the black neighborhood, known locally as Shake Rag.
About two blocks up the street here, that several white families had moved in and out there. And of course, the Presley family is one of the families that moved in the area up there when Elvis was a little boy, running up and down the streets. We all lived in this area, and we all got along very well up here. Sure they did. Everybody was in the same condition, and we never had any other way of life, and we all just lived together here, and sure they'd shop in the store. Well, they'd bring their needs. Whatever their needs were, they'd come to the store and get them. And like everybody else.
All over the South, black musicians were sitting out on their porches, singing out their lives.
He had rhythm. He had natural rhythm. He had developed natural rhythm. Yeah, he had rhythm with feeling. He felt his rhythm. That's why he was able to perform it like he did. Yeah, he couldn't have gotten that from any other source other than the black musicians.
With these influences of church music, country music, and local black blues, Elvis began to think of himself as a performer. When he was 10, he won second prize in the State Fair talent show. He gave them an old favorite. Presley always believed her son was special and that he must get an education. She encouraged him in every way she could and was doubtless concerned for his progress when, just as he was settling into high school, Vernon gave up trying to make a country living and moved his family to the city.
The star was shining bright and they whispered from on high, your love has said goodbye. Blue moon of Kentucky, keep on shining, shine on the one that's gone and said goodbye.
In 1948, I met Elvis at Humes Junior High School when he moved up from Tupelo, Mississippi, and we had a music class together. And I remember very vividly, he brought his guitar to class and he sang a couple of country songs, and he was sort of a quiet individual in school. So, you know, real shy and laid back, but when he got up in front of the class to sing, or when he got up on stage to sing, he was not bashful at all. They were tough kids, real rough kids. They didn't cause any problems, but they were brought up, it was a tough neighborhood, and you just had to sort of be on your P's and Q's, so to speak, so you didn't get any problems with other kids, because there were some really tough kids in the neighborhood. It's a tough school.
After a few months in rented rooms, the Presleys were assigned to an apartment in a municipal housing project for the poor known as Lauderdale Courts. When you enter the building, you know at once what it means to be poor in Tennessee. It means you sweat. The air is humid and fetid.
Elvis did look different in high school. He had long hair. If you can visualize this, in the 50s, his hair was as long as the Beatles when they came out in 64. And that's quite a thing there, because most of the kids in high school in those days had short hair. Also, Elvis wore extravagant clothes. Where most of the kids would wear jeans and t-shirts, Elvis would wear a sport jacket, maybe a black sport jacket with a pink stripe trimmed down it. Or he would wear a black pair of pants with a white stripe down the side. You could tell the show business influence was starting early on in his life.
Elvis was a rebel, but not an outlaw. He obeyed his mama and did his best in school. He was regular at church and developed a passion for gospel music. And precisely because Gladys trusted him, he had considerable freedom to discover what Memphis had to offer.
To face temptation sore,
he also had to help the family income by working after school as a cinema usher. Lowe's Cinema was just around the corner from the cradle of the blues.
Elvis was going to Beale Street. You had Bo Diddley, Big Boy Crudup. He listened to a lot of blues. And when Elvis started, that was Roy Brown, Winona Harris. He would have listened to numerous entertainers during that time, because all of them basically were good. There was something out there that was musical. Elvis was musical, and that was something that he liked, and he listened to it, and he played it, and he learned it, and he learned it well.
Our senior year in high school, there was a talent show, and Elvis was in the talent show, and the person who got the most applause got to do the encore. And actually, Elvis got the most applause, and he got to do the encore, and he was really tremendously excited about winning the high school talent show.
After high school graduation, Elvis took a couple of factory jobs. But he had it in mind to train as an electrician.
Well, now you're back, don't want to leave me, and I'm not gonna let you stay.
A lady that was a friend of ours at the unemployment agency, she called us and said that she had a nice young man that needed a job and wanted to work, and so we asked her to send him over and we'd interview him.
He had just came from the employment office, and the lady up there called me up and told me, do not take this boy's looks to be bad. He is good, and his mother and him, he needs some help. So he came down to see us, and that is when he went to work for us the next day. He got long hair. It was real thick and, you know, looked like it was pasted down, really. That's what it looked like.
And he would go out on his runs, and he'd come back in, and he'd run into the bathroom, and he'd stroke his hair up, and we all laughed at him about that. When he wasn't driving the truck, why, he'd help the electricians on the job pull wire or put up some pipe or whatever they needed him for do.
They'd get him all around the piano, and they'd want him to play the music for him. And he was always gone for an hour and a half or 2 hours at a time, because he was entertaining everybody. He just said what he wanted to do is to get in some kind of business, like where he could take and make his mother a living, where she would not have to struggle for it anymore.
Gladys and I both just loved him. If, you know, as we don't have any children, but we just thought the world of him.
Elvis could not have been in a better place than Memphis as far as music was concerned. As well as the blues on Beale, he heard white and black radio stations on the local channels.
Train I ride, 16 coaches long. Well, that long black train.
Memphis also had Sam Phillips.
These untrained musicians in the Mid-South from the Delta of Mississippi, the Delta of Arkansas, West Tennessee, Southeast Missouri, Northwest Alabama. You had a combination of country people, I mean really country musicians, amateur musicians, black and white, the likes of which no other section in this land had. That was a great thing to draw on, and I knew it.
Sam ran a sideline to help the cash flow, a recording service for amateurs. As Elvis drove his truck up and down Union Street, he worked up the courage to go in and make a disc. He wanted to hear how he sounded.
He came in, and he said he wanted to make a record, and I told him he'd have to wait. Mr. Phillips was not there at the time. The thing I always notice about a person, I notice eyes, mouth, and the hands, and of course Elvis's remarkable eyes, and that strange little half smile hovering there, and his hands very tense around his guitar. And the conversation, as best I recall it, was, do you know anybody looking for a singer? And I think I said, what kind of singer are you? And he says, well, I sing everything. I said, who do you sing like? I don't sing like nobody. I just sing like, I thought, oh dear, yes, well, all right. And I decided that I would make the record myself. Halfway through, I began really to listen to him, and I felt this faint, strange feeling, which I can only describe as the hair standing up on the back of my neck. I thought, oh, I want Sam to hear this. Sam's been saying he wanted to find a white man who sounded black, and I felt that's what was happening here. The really magic moment in Elvis's career, the real turning point, came one Saturday afternoon, one very rainy, bad Saturday afternoon, when Sam decided to tackle a great stack of demos that had been sent in. I was out front at my desk, but I could hear through the monitor out front what was happening. And he put on a record that was a single black man with a guitar, acoustic guitar, singing a very simple little ballad called Without You.
Always at twilight, I wish on a star. Ask God to keep you wherever you are.
Sam tried in vain to locate this singer, but he was never found.
And time to regret.
So giving in to Marion, he called in Elvis to have a go at the song.
This guy came in with the long sideburns. If you can believe this, a little bit greasy, which I didn't mind. I mean, greasy looking. This guy knocked me out. He came in and just had that contact. And the most amateurish contact in the world, but one you could feel. Hey,
I liked it. I wanted to see what this damn fool could do. Anyway, listen. I opened the microphone, turned this guy on, listened to him do an Ink Spots number, play around a little bit, just with his guitar. It was different. Different. Hey, that's all I've ever looked for in my life. Be different.
Sam didn't like Elvis's efforts at Without You, but he did hear something.
I arranged for Scotty Moore and Bill Black to work with Elvis, and I said, this guy needs a little more time on the farm, so to speak. He really does. One day we were ready to pack up their three instruments, and Elvis cut down on That's All Right, Mama. He was just flogging the guitar, and even off mic, it had impact. I mean, he was on top of that song, That's All Right, Mama.
Well, that's all right, Mama. That's all right for you. That's all right, Mama. Just any way you do it, that's all right. That's all right.
The B-side of Elvis's first disc was his old Bill Monroe favorite, Blue Moon of Kentucky. Sam took the first lacquer down to his friend Dewey Phillips, who ran his show from the Chiska Hotel.
Dewey Phillips did a nighttime show called Red Hot and Blue, wherein he played mostly black music in those days. It's 1954, 55, 56. Very popular personality at night. All the kids, all the white teenage kids and all the blacks listened to Dewey Phillips. He had enormous ratings.
Oh, yes, sir, good people. So, Phillips, which bring the hottest cotton picking thing to cut, the real hot blue, coming through WHBQ and Hotel Chiska on the magazine floor. It's the right days.
Don't tell them Phillips sent you from Red Hot and Blue.
Well, and you, I got a new song we're going to play here. They're going to cut loose this new song.
When Dewey put the record on, he got such incredible response on the phone. It was like Christmas tree lighting up. It just, people out listening to the radio couldn't get enough of it. He played one side and then the other, one side and then the other. And there was all this incredible excitement around this first playing of this record. So much so that Dewey said, where's Elvis? Let's get him down here. They found him, and Elvis came up there, and he didn't really realize that Dewey Phillips was interviewing him on the radio, because he said later, if I'd known I was on the radio, I would have been scared to death. I couldn't talk, because in those early days, at this particular time, Elvis was very withdrawn, and he just, you know, was very shy.
Well, I heard you knew that's good to rock it tonight. Well, I heard you knew that's good to rock it tonight.
I was on a show in Memphis where I started doing that, a big jamboree in an outdoor theater. Everybody was hollering, and I didn't know what they were hollering at. And my manager told me that they was hollering because I was wiggling my legs.
I say, oh, meet me in a hurry behind the bar. Don't you be afraid, I'll do you no harm. I want you to bring along my rocking shoes, cause tonight I'm going to rock away all the blues. I heard the news, there's good to rockin' in that.
He appeared on the Grand Ole Opry and went over pretty good, I thought. But I heard him one night in the studio, he told us, yeah, I said, I played on the Grand Ole Opry. He was talking on the mic and we were in the control room. Mr. Denny says, we don't like that nigger music around here. Go back to Memphis and drive a truck. I remember I was very astonished to see him because he had mascara. Up here, or up there, or somewhere, I don't know where it was. He had eye makeup on, and I'd never seen that on a man before.
Maybelline, why can't you be true? Oh, Maybelline, why can't you be true?
Elvis didn't belong on the Grand Ole Opry, but they loved him at the Louisiana Hayride.
There was a motivating over the hill.
He also found a drummer there.
A Cadillac rolling on an open road.
So, Scotty, come over and said, Dave, would you mind backing me up, backing the band up? I said, certainly, you know. I said, well, let's do go back in the dressing room and talk about it for a minute. Let's don't go out there cold. So when me and Elvis and Scotty and Bill went back and played two or three little things, you know, and they said, that's fine. And we went out and done the show, and it worked. It was just one of those things that happened, you know. But like I said, they had such a unique sound. I got a thing, I said, well, now if I clutter them up, it's going to be bad. So I just played a heavy backbeat for them. I think that's why I got the job. I stayed out of their way. You know, I let them play what they played well. It was 7 days a week, a different town every night. And it got kind of old after a while. It got a little bit testy sometimes, you know. You get four guys tied up in a car, cooped up like that, and boy, you want to kill somebody. As a young man, he was a real super hyper guy. And you had to kind of walk him down the road to... He'd get through the show and he was just a nervous wreck. Somebody would walk him down the road for a mile or two. Somebody had to do it just to, you know, knock the edge off of him a little bit. Because we had to drive, and he wanted to sit up and listen to the radio and talk all night, you know, just about everything. He didn't care what you talked about as long as he was talking. So we'd walk down the road with a mile or so, and somebody would come back and pick us up. And we'd put him in the back seat, he'd go to sleep like a baby.
Variously known as the Hillbilly Cat, the King of Western Bop, and the Memphis Flash, Elvis was soon the hottest act in the Southland. Now he needed someone to spread the word to the Yankees.
I first heard Elvis Presley on records when the records came into the studio, and there was a record of Blue Moon of Kentucky, an old Bill Monroe country tune that I liked. If I felt that a record was going to be an important record and I got it at 2 o'clock, I could play it at 2:10. I could play it again at 3. I could play it again at 4. I had at one time 60% of the radio audience in a city like Cleveland. I was able to saturate the entire market with that record in 2 or 3 days. And I had a Saturday night rock and roll party. And that was the first interview with Presley. Very gentlemanly, very interesting. He knew a lot about the music and the people and the personalities in Memphis, and it was very exciting. Bob Neal was there also. Bob Neal, to my mind, was a really interesting person. He was very bright. He was a country disc jockey, but he was also a businessman, entrepreneur, a hustler, but with a lot of class, I think. And he was the first manager of Elvis Presley.
Baby, well, I want you to know. Come on back and let's play a little house we can act like we did before. Now, baby, come back, baby, come.
Elvis and his band were often booked on Hank Snow's Jamboree show. The brains behind that outfit was Colonel Tom Parker, who was duly impressed. Not by Presley, but by the crowd's reaction.
Come on back to me, little girl, so we can play some house now, baby.
Parker suggested to Steve Scholes, a senior man at RCA, that they buy the boy.
Come back, baby, I want to play house with you. All right, play house.
The reason he got Colonel Parker was because Parker was involved with Eddie Arnold and Hank Snow, who were both Victor artists. The Colonel and Steve Scholes were in bed together with a number of deals like that. So it was just an add-on deal that they could all work out well together. It turned out to be a wonderful windfall for Colonel Parker. They made the deal where they all went together. Steve Scholes, Sam Phillips sold out, RCA Victor was in, and everybody was off and running in a wonderful ride all the way to the bank. He was a highly astute carnival barker who made it big. He got a good property and he ran with it most of his life. He certainly was, it's hard to say really what Colonel Parker was and be legal.
The next question I know that people will ask, are you sorry, Phillips, that you sold Elvis Presley's contract? Hell no. Man, I love the guy till this day. At the same time, I would have never wanted anybody to think that Sun Records was a one label, one artist label, you know? Sure, it was a gamble. I needed the money. I needed the money. He happened to be the only one that I could get a dollar for at that time, basically. So it was a good thing for me, and it wasn't a bad thing for Elvis.
RCA had a little studio over on McGavick Street. We made records there in a terrible studio with an arched roof, so that when you played a bass note. It went up in the ceiling and rolled around and came back at you a little later. It was a terrible place. We also had tape reverberation, where you take you erase here, record here, and playback here. You take a little of the playback and add it here, and you get Heartbreak Hotel, of course, which we used on Elvis. And it was pretty bad sound, but it was different. It was it had its own characteristics and everything.
And I went to meet him at the elevator, and he got off, and he gave me this huge grin and put out his hand and said, "Hello, ma'am." And that was typical of Elvis. He was a very charming kid. He refined his own performances as he went along. I mean, he always came into a studio prepared. He knew the words and pretty much knew what he wanted to do, but he would refine those performances as time would go on, and each take would be slightly different until he got what he wanted.
I love you because you understand it.
Elvis could now do the thing he had always promised himself. He bought his mama a house.
Single thing I tried to do. You're always there to lend.
He indulged some of his own tastes too.
I love you most of all.
And about this Judy Spreckles, I've been getting a lot of publicity with Judy Spreckles.
Uh-huh.
I got started when Judy gave me a ring out in Las Vegas. She gave me this ring here. And,
what ring there?
Somebody started it that she was wearing my ring and I was wearing her ring. We were wearing each other's rings.
That's the way it goes.
Elvis Presley was a highly sexed young guy. He was a Randy Rooster, actually, in that kind of colloquial terminology. And he was very active sexually. And there were always very well-developed young women and excited groupies, I guess you would call them at the time, who would congregate around backstage. And Elvis Presley's car was used not only to sell the records out of the trunk between the intermissions, but also it was a sexual assignation place. I mean, there was a lot of activity in that car.
You know, less than 2 years ago, you were earning $14 a week as a movie usher and then $35 a week for driving a truck in Memphis. Today, you're the most controversial name in show business. Has this sudden notoriety affected your sleep, your appetite, or the size of your head?
Not the size of my head. It's affected my sleep.
How much sleep do you get?
Well, I average about 4 or 5 hours a night, I guess.
Is that enough?
No, it's really not, but I'm used to it, and I can't sleep any longer.
I don't know whether you noticed the column the other day. They predict that Elvis Presley will be another James Dean. Now, have you heard that?
Well, I've heard something about it, but I would never compare myself in any way to James Dean, because James Dean was a genius in acting.
Mm-hmm.
Although I'll say that I sure would like to. I mean, I guess there's a lot of actors in Hollywood that would like to. I've had the ability that James Dean had, but I would never compare myself with James Dean in any way.
The love of the younger generation was matched by a loathing in many quarters. Elvis was seen by some as the devil incarnate. In Florida, his show was watched by the local moral guardians, and he was given a warning by the judge from juvenile court to curb his movements. But even the mighty Ed Sullivan, who had vowed never to have Elvis on a show, had to give in.
Gym to the sock hop ball. The gum and the cats are going wild. The misery is in my day. Ready to
Those kids that come here to pay their money to see this show come to have a good time. They're somebody's decent kids, probably, that was raised in a decent home. If they want to pay their money and come out and jump around and scream and yell, it's their business. They'll grow up someday and grow out of it.
In no way, shape, or form would he have wanted you to think he was vulgar. And, of course, for many reasons, for his mother's sake and his father's sake, but for your sake, he wouldn't have been. Elvis never told vulgar jokes. He wouldn't have wanted anything to have been vulgar. And I don't know why they got this up, but just, I guess a lot of church people thought it was vulgar the way he moved.
What song is your favorite that Elvis has recorded, Miss Presley?
Baby Toy House.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, that's a good one. And Don't Be Cruel.
Don't Be Cruel.
That's my two favorites.
Did you by chance get a chance to see the parade today?
No, sir, we didn't get here in time to see that. We was being told about that. We found out what Rohan was eating dinner.
Yes, ma'am.
About what a nice parade they had. And I wish then that we'd have got here in time.
Oh,
but
it
we didn't.
It was terrific.
Elvis's triumph was crowned by a return visit to Tupelo, his birthplace. All of Mississippi was wild about him.
I say I'm an even kind of baby. I'm an even kind of joke. Right a minute you won't be bothered with me. I'm around your door, but that's all right. That's all right. That's all right. I know my mind.
It'd be hard for me to tell you just how great it would be to be on the stage singing with him with some 25,000-30,000 people screaming out in the audience. You know, Elvis always said, the show is in the audience, not on the stage.
You ain't nothing but a hound. Been snooping on
the door. She was one of the saltiest blues shouters. She was really formidable. She was scary looking. And we liked her right away. And we were wondering what, you know, what to write for her. And I thought we just have to write something that sounds like someone just cussing somebody out, you know? And it came out, you ain't nothing but a hound dog.
You ain't nothing but a hound dog. Well, you ain't never gonna ever have no fear.
But at first, I thought it was terrible, and especially compared to the record we made with Big Mama Thornton. It was nervous. It was frenetic. It didn't have any real groove.
But it had in it the same
high energy.
No, it wasn't just the high. It was a higher energy. It was a different, more nervous energy. But it had the same feeling in the delivery ultimately, which was anger.
Well, you ain't never gonna.
Music publishers who controlled Elvis Presley music contacted us and asked if we had any other material that we thought might be good for Elvis. And Jerry remembered a song that we had done with a duet on our own record label called Love Me, and we submitted it, and they submitted it to Elvis, who did it.
Treat me like a fool. Faithful heart, tear it all apart. Sir, love me.
Won't you love me?
Wherever you go, darling, I'll be oh so lonely. I'll be sad and blue.
I think he did it brilliantly. In fact, brilliant is really the wrong word. He did a beautiful job on the song. It's the best record of the song ever made, and it's It's my favorite Elvis Presley recording of a song that we wrote.
He would beg and plead
just to
feel. Yes, just to feel.
Oh, heart,
I want your heart.
Be lost in mine.
So close to my will.
Go, darling, I'll be home. Begging on my knees, all I ask is please, please love me. Oh,
yeah. When the Sullivan people decided just to shoot him from the waist up, really Elvis couldn't understand. He said, "Vulgar, you know, there's nothing vulgar about the way I move."
Well, I'm tired and so weary, but I must go along. Till the Lord comes and calls me away, oh yes. Well, the morning's so bright, and the lamb is alight, and the night, night is as black. There will be peace in the valley for me someday. There will be peace in the valley for me. Oh, Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow,
oh, my Lord, no trouble,
trouble I see.
Like God in those days, and he said, "This is really an all right boy. This is really a super nice person." He said, "Of all the people that we've had on our shows, we've never had anyone that we've had a better experience with than Elvis Presley." And that's really, really, I think, the thing that really opened the American public to accept Presley, because they had really been putting him down. Many people told us, "You better get it while you can, because he ain't going to be around long."
Now wait a minute. I wanted to say to Elvis Presley and the country that this is a real, decent, fine boy. And wherever you go, Elvis, the guys who accompany you over there, we want to say that we've never had a pleasanter experience on our show with a big name than we've had with you. You're thoroughly all right. So now, let's have a tremendous hand for a very nice person.
Just to feel.
Yes, just to feel.
Part two, tomorrow evening, Cut Me and I Bleed, takes us through the rest of Elvis's life, from the long episode of movie making, his marriage to Priscilla, and a return to the pleasures of live performance, right up to the darkness and isolation of his final years. And that's at 9:30 tomorrow. 50 of his greatest hits, starting at 5:30 in the morning until 7:30 in the legend of Elvis continues with part two of his story, detailing the glory.